Well, good morning, everybody. I can barely see you just because the lights are so bright this morning, and it's not very bright outside. Welcome to Ignite. Steve is not here. Hopefully, you have received the email to get the update on that, but if not, I'll explain a little bit more about that here in a little bit. Since he's not here, though, I did want to open this up in a word of prayer, so if you would you stand with me this morning as we open in a word of prayer, and then we will open with worship as well. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you that we are able to gather here today in your name and worship you, Father, and listen to your word being preached. I pray that your blessing would be upon all of us, Father, that our hearts would be open to hear what you have to teach us today. And Father, we pray for all of those who are hurting and suffering from the things that are going on in this world, and ask your hand of blessing and your hand of healing to be upon them. We love you, we praise you, we thank you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Here we go.
You wrestle with the sinners.
sounded amazing this morning. And so thankful that you're here with us in person. And those of you who are joining us online, we want to continue the worship this morning, singing a song we've introduced a few months ago and bringing it back again, singing about how we've entombed ourselves so often with different things in this life, things that have taken us off track of following the Lord, but he has released us from those things, or the chains are gone, the chains are broken, and we can simply run out of our graves into his glorious day.
Well, I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind away? It was my tomb till I met you. Well, I was breathing, but not alive. And all my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called.
Morning with another song honoring our Lord and Savior. But the beautiful thing about this song is, in a world that seems to be able to tell us how we should think and who we should be and all these things, I don't know if you've ever felt that way, but I've always felt like the world tries to fit you into a mold that they see as best fit for your life, and that's not who I am as a Christian. I am who he says I am, and he calls me a child of the King. And that holds more foundation than anything this world could ever offer me, riches, fame, glory, any of those things. I am who he says I am. Would you sing that with us this morning?
His love for me, who the Son.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause again in the middle of this service, giving you honor and glory and praise for who you are, and Father, for telling us we are who you say we are. We don't have to listen to the voice of the world, Father, we just need to listen to your voice. Father, help us to listen to your voice closely today and always, even as we leave this place in this dark and tumultuous world. Father, help us to be the shining beacons of light you have prepared for us to be. God, we just pray that you would have your hand of blessing upon the rest of this service. We love you, praise you, and thank you. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated this morning. So as the band makes their way down, a little bit of explanation is coming your way this morning. So for those who do not know, Steve is in quarantine. Steve is at home, and I would love to tell you that I am so technically amazing that we can live stream him from his house and bring him right here to live with you, but I'm not that good yet. But we did make some other preparations for him to still be able to bring the message to you this morning. I do want to forewarn you. So he's in quarantine, so I'm not able to be near him in any way, shape, or form, or help him with the recording. So we did the best that we could with what we had, and it's still here for us today. The audio is going to be a little bit off. I did my best to filter it for you to make it where it is listenable, if you will. But if you'll direct your attention to the screens, we'll go ahead and get that sermon rolling this morning.
Well, it's great to be with you this morning, at least somehow, if not in person. And just grateful for the modern technology and just the opportunity to still be a part of this time of worship this morning. I want to share a scripture passage as the basis of my message this morning, and it's found in Isaiah chapter 11 and verses 1 through 10. Hear these words from the Word of God. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. The spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the spirit of counsel and of might, the spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy, with justice he will give decisions for the poor on the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. That will neither harm them nor destroy on all my holy mountain. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. And in that day, the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for the peoples. The nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, as we continue our message series, Read the Bible for Life, seeking to better understand the big picture of the Bible, how the individual stories of the Bible fit into the overarching themes and how they apply to our lives and our world, we're going to look specifically at a portion of the Old Testament of the Bible today known as the prophets, or the books of the prophets, Isaiah being one of the prophets of ancient Israel. Now, before I get specifically to Isaiah and the specific passage from the Bible that I just read, I want to talk about what a prophet was in ancient Israel. Now, when we hear the word prophet or prophecy, we typically think of predicting the future. However, the Old Testament prophets tended to be more like preachers or teachers, helping people understand God's will on the issues of the day, but then occasionally also incorporating a word of God for the future into their message. And as we're going to see, just as with the Bible as a whole, there were certain overarching themes that the prophets often spoke about. Isaiah, the human author of the book of Isaiah, lived somewhere around 700 to 750 years before the time of Jesus Christ. Now, this passage actually points to Jesus. When it says in verse 1, Jesus is the shoot that will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a bad branch will bear fruit. See, that's referring to Jesus. Jesse's son was David, the greatest king in the history of ancient Israel, and Jesus was a direct descendant of King David. Why ancient Israel ceased to exist because they did not keep the covenant. That they rebelled against God many times, in fact, and then God eventually cut them off. The tree was cut down. Yet out of God's incredible love, he renews the covenant through the new covenant, Jesus, the shoot that grows up out of the stump of that old tree. And the covenant is carried on and renewed through Jesus. And verses 2 and following clearly are also referring to Christ. And then particularly in verses 6 and following here in Isaiah chapter 11, Isaiah also prophesied this promise from God that one day all the wars and fighting that had worn them down, maybe not all that unlike the chaos that often fills our lives and world and robs us of our peace, that one day the wars and struggles, the challenges and fighting would end and peace would reign. Now, this isn't going to be fully accomplished until Christ returns to this world a second time. In power and glory, the Bible says every knee will bow and every tongue or mouth confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. However, even though that won't be fully accomplished until that time, this is a picture of what God calls us to work for, that kind of world. We know that for now, we often end up kind of feeling like we're fighting a losing battle, which is a part of living in a world where sin and evil exist. However, striving to make this world more like the kind of place that God would want it to be is what we're supposed to be about as Christians. Now, in the midst of war and suffering, the people of ancient Israel were given a picture of a day when wolves and lambs would hang out together like best friends, a day when the cow and the bear would both eat grass together instead of the bear eating the cow, and even a day when young children would play around with deadly snakes and not be hurt. And no, that's not talking about snake-handling churches. Remember, although we are supposed to work for that kind of world, it isn't going to come about until Jesus returns at the end of time. But it does give us a picture of the kind of world that we are to work for and which one day we will get to be a part. And in the process of pointing to Jesus and a better day here in Isaiah chapter 11 and verses 1 through 10, we get a powerful glimpse of what God desires for us and our world. And I want to spend a little time today sharing several overarching themes from the books of the prophets and how they relate to our lives and our world. First, again and again throughout the books of the Bible known as the prophets, we find this reference to the covenant that I spoke of so much of last week and calling God's people back to the special relationship for which he originally created human beings. Here in Isaiah chapter 11, we also have a reference to the new covenant that would one day come through Jesus, and of course now has. These invitations from God through the prophets also often came with a warning that bad things would come if the people continued to resist God and go their own way. That God would judge them, typically by allowing their enemies to overcome them, because God's power and protection were withdrawn from them. And indeed, in 722 BC, the Assyrian Empire defeated the northern part of the nation of Israel. And then later, in 586 BC, the Babylonian Empire, which had defeated and replaced the Assyrian Empire, conquered the rest of the nation, the southern part, Judah, and the capital city of Jerusalem. So not only did these prophets from God bring messages to the people, often these messages were warnings to the people, attempts to get them to come back to God and once again obey and follow the commands and rules that God had given them that would benefit and bless their lives and their society, keep them from harm and keep them close to God. And these words of both blessing and warning, calling people back to this covenant relationship, this special relationship with God, are repeated again and again and again throughout the Old Testament prophets. And while there were lots of unique situations among the different prophets, one of the messages that we need to hear as we read the prophets, these books from the Bible, is that it is really easy to drift in our relationship with God. That God wants to pour out His love and His blessing into our lives. That He loves us so much and wants us to experience that love and blessing in our lives, both in this world and then one day even forever. That He will also allow challenges, struggles, and even pain and hardship in order to get our attention and attempt to redirect us back into His loving and protecting arms. Bottom line, friends, God knows what is best for us. That's why He's God. He created us. And because He loves us so very much, He tells us what is best for us and what isn't. And just as God regularly sought to call the people of ancient Israel back to Him, He loves us with an incredible love and is always wooing us, almost like a lover, passionately desiring that He would be our only one and that we would be faithful to Him and promising to shower us with His love if we commit our lives to Him. When it's easy, and even when it's not so easy. Well, in addition to always calling His people back to that special relationship with Him, a second theme that we see throughout the prophets of ancient Israel is pointing to a better future that God is preparing. So even as there is often warning of impending judgment and doom, there is also this vision of a better and brighter future, that things would not always be gloom and doom. And again, we find this in verses 6 to 9 in these references, like a day when the wolves and lambs would hang out together like best friends. And as I mentioned earlier, although this was only partially accomplished in this world when Jesus came the first time, it was probably referring more to the peace that we can experience internally through Christ than world peace, which will not be fully accomplished until Jesus comes back in power and glory. It is still a picture of the kind of world that God would desire and the kind of world that we should be working to bring to pass. So often when I hear Christians talk about this world, it sounds more like a call to hunker down and ride out the challenges of life rather than to engage our world for God and seek to lead as many to Christ as possible in the process. You know, just until my life is over, Jesus returned, I'm just going to hunker down. That's wrong. We are supposed to reach as many people for Christ as possible, but we are also supposed to be working to make this world more like the kind of place that God would want it to be, and reaching as many people as we can for Jesus in the process. I mean, that's the only way to experience a better and brighter future in this life. We Christians of all people should be people of hope and possibility, not people of gloom and doom. And this leads us right into the third overarching theme that I would like to share with you today, that we find many, many times throughout the prophets, and that is a call to make a social impact in our world. As we seek to proclaim the name of Jesus, to work to make society a better place to live, to fight for those who get pushed to the periphery and run over, to lift up those who are beaten down or cast aside. In biblical terminology, to care for the widow, orphan, and stranger in our midst. Now, this is referred to in verse 4 of Isaiah chapter 11, but I want to show you Isaiah chapter 10, in verses 1 through 4, because it's a little bit more in depth along this line. And it says, "Woe to those who make unjust laws, to those who issue oppressive decrees, to deprive the poor of their rights, and withhold justice from the oppressed of my people, making widows their prey and robbing the fatherless. What will you do on the day of reckoning when disaster comes from afar? To whom will you run for help? Where will you leave your riches? Nothing will remain but to cringe among the captives or fall among the slain. Yet for all this, his anger is not turned away. His hand is still upraised." What does that mean? Well, basically, it's saying that God has a special place in his heart for the marginalized, those on the periphery of society, the have-nots, and that we better be working in the name of Jesus to better their lives in this world. That this is almost a little bit of a threat to the haves of the world, that they have a responsibility to look out for the have-nots. Friends, this stuff is all over the Old Testament, and if you happen to print off the bulletin that Barb sends out of the office each week, I've got some notes there. It's in Isaiah 1, Isaiah 58, Jeremiah 22, Amos 5, Micah 6. It's also in the New Testament, Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46, and also in Luke 4. In the early church, there was great care for the widows and the orphans. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, worked diligently among the poor in England during the 1700s, seeking to help them with alcoholism and job training and winning many thousands to Christ in the process, and is credited with perhaps helping England avoid a bloody revolution like France experienced. In the United States, in the first half of our nation's history, it was Methodist Christians who built hospitals and schools and helped fight for women's rights and stood against slavery and alcohol abuse. From very early on in the Old Testament until the early 1900s in the U.S., Christians were both evangelical and socially focused. Unfortunately, by the early to mid-1900s in our country, a split became clearly evident between evangelism espoused by so-called conservative Christianity and social impact, efforts to improve a society's social environment, especially espoused by so-called liberal Christianity. Liberal Christianity stopped focusing on personal salvation and focused exclusively on more social work and social agendas. More conservative Christianity significantly decreased its emphasis on improving conditions in general society and focused more exclusively on saving souls, and actually ended up making a far less impact on society because of it. You see, per the Bible, God is always designed for a social witness, seeking to better our society, and spiritual outreach, seeking to draw persons to Christ to go hand in hand. But now they have become separated, at least in our nation, 100 years or so ago. Today, there are very strong efforts to bring them back together again, as God had ordained it from the beginning of time. God always meant for us to spread his message of love and salvation in Christ as we sought to improve our world and look out for the poor and hurting among us. Whether that is helping economically challenged persons to learn trades and get jobs, or help the incarcerated make transition from inmates to productive members of society, or helping tutor children so that they will have a better shot at a meaningful life in this world. We are to go out into the world and seek to make it a better place by leading as many people into a loving, saving relationship with Jesus Christ as we possibly can, and seek to make it a better place through a social witness, seeking to impact the conditions in our society. A social witness should not be left to those who do not view Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life, and the path to the Father, aka to God. We who believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life must reclaim our call to both an evangelical and a social witness. It is a mandate that we find throughout Scripture and throughout the history of the church, and the prophets of the Old Testament were all over it. Calling the people of God back into the depth and intimacy of a loving relationship with him, covenant. Painting a picture of a better and brighter future, no matter how challenging life may get. And reclaiming the Bible's mandate and call to all Christians to take our world the hope of Jesus as we seek to make it a better place in every way is what the prophets of the Old Testament were about. And those same messages should challenge us even today as we seek to live into the mandate to spread God's message of salvation to Christ, to all who will receive it. Those are the overarching messages of the prophets, this not as well known, but very important part of God's word. And I pray that we would reflect on how those impact us and our own lives even today. I want to invite us to take just a moment and lift up a prayer. Dear Heavenly God, Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, God, for the way that you speak to us. We thank you for the covenant that you have invited us into, God, nowadays through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Dear God, we thank you that no matter what life gets, no matter what life looks like, no matter the challenges that we face, that you give us hope for a better and a brighter future, even in this world, much less beyond it. And dear God, we pray that you would help us to seek to understand what it means to bring together the powerful witness of Jesus, the spiritual witness and relationship that is made possible, God, with this social impact that you have called your people to be about throughout history. Lord, if it has gotten separated in our lives, may we bring it back together with your help again. God, very powerful words, not only for several thousand years ago, but dear God, even for us today. May we seek to take them to heart and live them out so that we may open ourselves up to an even greater blessing, an even greater joy, and make an even greater impact in the hearts, minds, and lives of others, God, and in our world in which you have placed us. Lord, let it be so. May it be so, we pray. In Jesus' name.
Would you stand if you're able?
Sings my soul, my Savior God.
that beautiful song to close us with. And though things may have been a little bit different this morning, I pray that you still receive God's blessing from worship and from the preached word of God. And my hope and prayer for you today is that you leave this place different than what you came. And that's what the preaching of God's word and worshiping Him should do. We should be a changed people. We should never be the same every single day. God changes us, and if you allow Him to do it, He can change you to make you something just so amazingly beautiful. Have a blessed week. Go out and be safe this week in all that you do. Be a blessing to someone else. We love you guys, and we're glad you're here with us, and you are dismissed from this place this morning. Have a great and fantastic and wonderful week.
Yeah.